My talk will be about a kind of combination of the human rights to food and gender rights and climate change and kind of combination of all of them, because I think we cannot really differentiate many of the issues that we are dealing with today. They are all connected. I always start my talk wherever I go, human rights approach to food security and policy issues. I'm sure you all know as much as I know, but I still make this first entry, especially in Europe, why right to food is not a charity, but some kind of entitlement that we need to really mobilize ourselves. The one in one side is the state and right holders and the duty bearers. Then we need some kind of procedural system to ask our own governments if there's any violation, which is the transparency. We have to know the policies. What are they doing? What are the consequences? We have to participate into the decision making. And if there's any indiscrimination, we should have a right to correct this. And also, we have the right to go to court against this decision. These are the things that human rights approach is giving to us in relation to food policies, which means we talk about the human rights, but what it gives to us, these are the all areas that we can use. This is the legal structure. I'm sure you know, but I'm just making very short presentation on that. Universal Declaration 1948 started first, as you know, it's a quite long time ago. And then Economic and Social Rights 1966 came to in power, which economic and the right to food is Article 11. And then we have other international agreements and conventions that gives us directly or indirectly right to food protection, which is the Convention Against Discrimination Against Women and the Convention on Child Rights. These are the major, major legal responsibilities, and the most of the countries in the world signed and ratified, except very few. For instance, US is the only country didn't sign the Women's Rights Agreement and the Children's Rights Agreement, but most of the whole world signed. And again, a Universal Declaration of Human Rights universally accepted, which means there's a universally accepted principles. And then when you look at the Article 11, you have to really interpret this, what it gives to us, right to adequate food. In 1999, Economic and Social Committee made this kind of structural interpretation, which is we have to have an available food, accessible, this food is accessible, sustainable, and adequate. Sustainability came later, not in 1999, but a little bit later when the climate change and environment became important, they put the sustainable, include the sustainability in it. But if you look at the general today's our world, availability is not a big problem, but we have the accessibility, which means economic and physical accessibility problem, and the adequacy, which is nutrition, basically how we interpret adequacy, basically nutritious food is the adequate, and of course safety from the perspective of health. This is what right to food gives three ways of state's responsibility. States should respect and protect and fulfill. Respect is basically negative right. They don't have to do anything. But the protect and fulfillment is much more active participation into the policy to make the right to food acceptable. So these are the ABC of the right to adequate food. And what are the challenges? Because, as you know, we are still, we're not able to getting rid of the hunger around the world, and malnutrition is a serious problem. The challenges are economic and social and environmental. So I made this yellow, this because when I will try to explain late in this presentation, these three things: economically, poverty is a major problem in relation to gender and climate change and food security. And of course, social inequalities are very, very important. Gender is one of them. And then the environmental issues is climate change that will come together. That's why what relationship with we are dealing with in right to adequate food is gender perspective and climate change, kind of triangle from the perspective of the right-based approach. So this is climate change. Let's go right now. These are actually, if we come look at this gender, climate change, right to adequate food, they are not really related. That's very difficult. You have to relate them. In order to relate them, you have to push them every single area, every single UN bodies. You have to tell them you are connected with the others. So this is not simply easy, and we are not dealing with every report. Oh, they are very much connected. We have to do one way or that's a very problematic area. UNFCC, which is United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, is a very, very important convention. And in 1992, in the first, the second Rio meeting, the countries signed and ratified. This is the major structure of the climate change policy in a global world. What is the relationship with food, right to food issues, and the gender? Basically nothing. So we have to look at what happened in from after 1992 till to 2015 and 16, how we try to make them together. This Article 2 is the framework convention, is the only article that give the food, a world of food, a place, which is unfortunately, they are protecting food production. The food production is not basically what we are dealing with from the perspective of right to food. So first of all, convention is not a good way to dealing with the right to food issue from the justice point of view. Then we have the Beijing Declaration, which is the women's rights in 95. There was a big UN conference. And in 1995, actually, they clearly made the connection. They said women's rights are important in relation to climate change and food security. But unfortunately, since 95, no other institutions tried to make something disconnected. And until 2007, when we came to 2007, finally, they tried to talk about the important. Before people will not, we didn't even know this COP meetings, which parties meeting every year are meeting in different parts of the world, the general public were not interested in. In 2010, Cancun meeting, human rights concept came to the conversation, but not the legal documents. And similar thing also, after the food price crisis, the climate change people started to understand, oh, there's a serious issues here that connected with food and the climate change. And the gender aspect, food security aspect, and human rights aspect only came very, very recently. So what happened, go a little bit faster. We know very much about this 2015 Paris Agreement because it was a big time agreement. And this is the biggest revolutionary movement and everyone celebrated each other. French people were very happy. They drank together champagne. What did we do in Paris Agreement? Basically, nothing. I mean, this is very, very sad, actually, in relation to what we are talking about. There was a good article about the human rights, right to food, right to health, nutritious food, and gender equality. The last day, after the 2 weeks of discussion last day, this article disappeared, and it came to the preamble, some kind of human rights language, but not right to food. They put another human rights, but not right to food, because right to food is very important from the perspective of agricultural corporations. So, surprisingly, there was no right to food, but there's one word, I think, food security and production, which is not new. Food production was there anyway. So from the right to food perspective, and many perspectives, but this talk is not about Paris, so I'm not going details, but was not very revolution. So from the human rights perspective, we have to look at the vulnerable people, because we all have a right to have access to nutritious food. But from the perspective of human rights, we have to look at who are the really vulnerable people. We have to make a policy for them. You know all of them. This is approximately 1 billion people. It goes back and forth in every year from 805 to 795 or 810. It's basically 1 billion. And the poverty issue is more important, very connected, which is 3 billion people live less than $2 a day. We are talking about not 1 billion people, but 3 billion people. Many of them are malnourished also. And 1 billion children, they are in poverty. We are talking about these people. Not eating every day is a very important phenomenon in generally when we go to Africa and countries. And for instance, in Nigeria, only 28% people, not only, in Nigeria, 28% of people, India, 24%, and Peru, 14% people, they cannot eat every day. If you go to Rwanda, for instance, every other day. That's a very serious kind of statistic. So we shouldn't celebrate each other with any of the policies that we are dealing right now. These people, the vulnerable people, hungry or malnutritious people, live 95% of already very climate problematic area. They are subtropic regions. They are already climate insecure. Sub-Saharan Africa, Asia, small island states. And most of them are smallholder farmers, which more than 500 million. Many of them, almost 50% of them, are now in chronically hungry. And these people also produce of the local food of the 70% of the that world, the developing world, which is very limited land. So if we come to women, why women are special category? Why we are writing about reports about the gender perspective? You know better as much as I do, as you know, the women are now, depending on region, between 50% to 80% of the farmers are women, which is what we call the feminization of agriculture. Because of the financial situation, economic conditions, women are men are leaving for migration, and women left behind with the farm, with the children and elderly. So that's a serious kind of target that we have to deal with from the perspective of gender if we talk about the farmers and the food security. But for instance, strangely enough, in FAO, the gender department only was established 2007. You think that we talk about the feminism and food security, how important women in relation to food, there must be a kind of important work in the FAO many, many years. This is not true, unfortunately. That's very new. And the women are special category because they are also the more poor and food insecure because of the social problem, not only economical, environmental, but also social problem. If you look at the in household conditions, many parts of the world, women are the least and the last eaters and the less nutritious food. So, more importantly, women have to deal with the, in relation to climate change, is very important because they basically are responsible to bring the water, to bring dealing with the food preparations without any compensation, what we call care system. The care system is very important in farms and the right to food issues because these foods are, this works for women, responsibility under women, but they are not compensated and they are not part of the economic development. We don't even calculate easily the proportion of the women, what they bring to the table, because basically they are not registered economy. That's why many of the reports right now dealing with the women access to resources, if women access to resources, what will happen, how malnutrition will be 20-30% less, the livelihood of all the families are much higher, and you don't have to do extra anything, just if they access to resources, which means property, which is land, water, technology, seeds, and credit. If you look at generally in the whole global world, basically 14-15% of the agricultural land belong to women, even they are 70-80% of the workers. This is not only in Africa or South Asia. If you look at, for instance, countries like Spain, countries like Italy, countries like Turkey in the Mediterranean, most of the farms belong to either fathers or brothers or the husbands, and they are only workers. This is not legally. This is the FAO's figure, which is very interesting. Colors really gives us more understanding what is happening from 1 degree to the 5th degree of increase of the global warming. I'm talking about just the global warming. There are other things, for instance, in climate change, sea level rise, the drought, and all other things indirectly impacted the crops. But here, food, water, ecosystem, the extreme weather events, and the risks are getting bigger and bigger and serious. Right now, we are talking about 1.5 degree increase. We're already there. And if you look at the Paris Agreement, the countries' commitments never gonna keep us in 1.5. This is very clear. So we have to go to between 2 to 3 degrees. How are we gonna find the results of the, of course, these are all predictions, but the serious and very conservative predictions. The predictions are basically comes from IPCC, Intergovernmental Panel of the Climate Change, which is 300 scientists around the world. They do write their reports, and these reports are very, very conservative because the governments are reading them. So it is not kind of like some NGOs is writing this and they exaggerate the results. It's a very conservative results. So what is the connection between climate change and food systems? It's an extremely uneasy relationship, but I would generally explain the climate change, the agriculture is the victim of the climate change and also perpetrator of the climate change. because they create more and more greenhouse gas emission than many other sectors, which basically very much under the radar screen until now. And the climate change really affects these all the issues that we are talking about. Melting water reserves, for instance, water is the most important. 70% of the fresh water goes to the agriculture, and these are under very serious threat. How many minutes? Okay, so I'm not going details about the climate change. Who impacts most? Of course, industrial agriculture, you all know, they create a lot of greenhouse gas emission. And the argument is because the population will be very high in 2050, for instance, then we need to get a more production. There's only the policy that getting more production, which makes our life more miserable. And the water problem, I already said, it's going down and down, irrigation. There is no new water resources right now. We all have already using them, and there is no more soil. And soil degradation is very, very important problem because of the more industrial agriculture, which is basically fossil fuel-oriented industrial agriculture. We talk about it. They use a lot of oil, chemicals, and transportation, all kind of things. So this is how industrial food system contributes to the climate crisis. It's not only 14% or 15% livestock greenhouse gas emission. We keep talking about. That's amazingly more higher if we talk about the transportation, refrigeration, all the food systems from the farm to our table going in the cycle is huge. I'm not even talking about the wasting, which is 40% that we are wasting. How climate change affects women? All these issues affects women more than other people because climate change is basically threat multiplier. Whatever we have, we're going to have a more and more. So how are we going to deal with the women's rights or a gender perspective of the food security from the perspective of climate change? These are the reports that how equal, we have to first make sure that has to be the equal access to resources and the power, empowerment of women. How are we going to do it? That is the question. We know we should do it. We know we should do it financial resources. We know we should do it production resources. We know we have to give them a more land and resource rights. And we know we give them a more services. But are we really doing this? So that's the problem. Generally, we talk about the climate change policies. When you look at the climate, the UNFCCC, UN Convention of the Climate Change, we have this mitigation policies and adaptation process. These policies never take seriously gender perspective. They all are highly technical, highly sophisticated projects, and never pay attention about the ordinary people's lives, how they are impacting their lives. If you look at the policies that so far we are now looking mitigation or adaptation, it's completely wrong. For instance, biofuel. We all know biofuel. Biofuel is an alternative kind of energy for cars, but they are also alternative to food. Whose food is in danger? Basically developing countries. Even in the United States, 40% of corns are going to biofuel, not for the people. Other 40% goes to the human, the animal feed. But that's the biofuel, which is very serious problem. Part of the good alternative for climate change. And another issue, which I'm sure my friend will talk about, some of the issues, clean development mechanism, they bring to meetings in Paris in a very big way, how we're gonna deal with the greenhouse gas emission reduction. This is basically commodification of environment. Commodification of the environment in the places, in the remote places, the kind of indigenous people, the forests, and how they do it, the big corporations, they go, they make a kind of, let's say, tree planting, which will be the reduction of the greenhouse gas emission, and the villagers completely taken out from the place. So why we cannot deal with more comprehensive policy that protects the environment, reduce the climate change, still people have livelihood? That is the problem. So, sorry. So I think I'm finishing. My proposal is we have to look at from the human rights perspective to deal with the women, children, indigenous people, that they are basically major malnourished people in the world, and the more hungry, while we have to deal with the climate change policies. Thank you very much, and I'm ready to answer your questions.
As I was presented, I'm Graciela Romero. I am studying at the Center for Agroecology, Water and Resilience at Coventry University, and I am honored to be there. I think I am surrounded of really, really good people and doing amazing work. And this work that I'm going to present with you is the result of some collaborative work that I was doing with some women in Peru. And it's not part of what I'm doing at the moment in CORE, because I'm working on the urban agriculture, very urban agriculture in Cuba. So this is more related to the previous work that I was doing at War on Want, but also my own activism with people in Peru. And also is related to the extractivism connected to food sovereignty. And make the connection between food sovereignty or food systems and what is happening with the extractivism, or even with the environment, the environmental movements. So I want just to say that this talk is also in honor of Berta Cáceres, who was killed in Honduras for fighting for water. So I think it's also for her and for all the women that are fighting and that are always behind the scenes in the movements, in the house, in everywhere. So I think this is for her as well. So I just want to start to say that when I was there in Peru, in Cajamarca, in the mountains of Peru, people were talking about the lakes, but they weren't talking about the lakes in the way that we say, okay, water to produce food. And this is what I want to basically highlight in this talk, is to say we are talking about different paradigm on how we understand the world. We are not seeing nature or the world as a dead entity, as a neutral entity. It's a living being. And that's what the indigenous people in Latin America and the people in Peru are saying. Pachamama, Mother Earth, is a living being. And this is what you see, the lake, the Yanacocha Lake, prior to the extractive of gold by Minera Yanacocha, which is a consortium of three Newmont in the States, the World Bank and Buenaventura in Peru. So this is what you have, and this is what they are fighting for the lakes, not because per se for water, because it's a living being, because it's also related to the entities that live there, the spirit that live there. It's culture, it's a way of living. So this is what they are defending. And then 20 years later, you find this. This is what you find after 20 years of gold extraction by Minera Yanacocha. And then you make the connections, because surrounding this is not, going back about the conception of interrelatedness of human beings and spirits and the nature, you see this is not just the mind, it's all what is around that. And it's about food production, it's about soil, about land, about people, about women. So I just want to go back about the idea of a different paradigm, a different understanding of how we can live. And I want to start with the issue about development and extractivism in the way that Western world conceive. And of course, people will say extractivism is important to be able to achieve development, to be able to achieve growth. How on earth are we going to get eradicate poverty or get food security if we don't have, we cannot extract the resources from Mother Earth? Or for that matter, if we cannot extract food to be able to sell to some parts of the world to be able to get money or foreign currency for your own country. And even countries that are talking about this new conception of the world, some of them are in favor of that extractivism. But then what I learned in Peru, and this is a map that shows that the whole, how extractive of minerals is around the whole country. Is that the red color shows the concentration of extractivism. Peru is one of the places where there are more conflicts, social conflicts, because of the extractive of minerals. And it's the 200 concessions to corporations, and also from the national corporations, foreign corporations and national corporations extracting minerals in Peru. And what that has brought in those years is poverty. In Cajamarca, in the place that I was visiting, when the gold extraction started in for Minera Yanacocha, they say this is going to be bring jobs, it's going to be food security for people, and there's going to be better off for people in Cajamarca. The reality is that in 2013, that report from the National Institute of Statistics in Peru reported that Cajamarca is one of the poorest regions in the whole country. So it's not something that you are just making this calculation, it's even the National Institute is providing the stats. And also there was another report made by the Law Center in the Columbia University in the States, also reporting the same problems in terms of poverty. But not just about poverty, it's the food security, insecurity. And I'm going to use this terminology at the moment because I think it's relevant. But I also don't want to confuse you with the idea of food security and food sovereignty that I'll talk later. And I think the previous speaker, she explained really well. The social conflicts and the criminalization of protest. There are several studies showing that extractivism, as a result of extractivism, there is social conflicts, and there have been many people, and I'm not going to use numbers here, but many people have been killed. And in this conflict, with Minera Yanacocha in Cajamarca, with the story that I'm going to tell you, five people were killed just at the beginning of the conflict, where they were saying, we don't want the extension of the Minera Yanacocha in Four Lakes in Peru, in Cajamarca. As a result of the 20 years of extraction of gold, what we have is, you can see in this picture, is the whole contamination of the water, where people have their animals feeding drinking water, but also is the water they have to use to be able to produce food. And I remember when I was starting to do this report, an article that I wrote, said, what is the connection with food? Well, the problem is that when you see reports from the government in Peru, or from reports in terms of development, they think, what is the comparison of few hundreds of peasants around that area, what is going to bring for the whole country? But the reality is those peasants are those who are going to bring food, not just for the surrounding areas, in terms of rural areas, but for the urban centers. Celendín, which is one of the small, it's the intermediate city, Cajamarca and Celendín, is provided by the food for these peasants around this area where the mine is. So all these people are suffering because of the contamination of the soil, of the water, and they are without livelihoods. What they are going to do? Going to the cities and then finding jobs here and there, what we see in many other places. So what happened with the food systems in those places? How they are going to survive? What are they going to eat when they lose their own way of providing their own food? They are losing their food sovereignty. So that's what people were telling me. And another thing really important was the contamination in one of the towns, the contamination of about 1,000 people or more with the spillage of mercury when they were transporting mercury in a responsible way. And they are still fighting for that. And people who started to fight for that were the people who were basically attacked by the state and by the Minerayana Cocha guards. So this is, you can see the militarization of the zone where the new mine was wanted to be in place. It's called Conga Mine. And it's called Conga because the lake where it's going to be is the original name, Conga. And it's four lakes. So there's one interesting issue. You might have heard about this. I hope you have heard this. This is the struggle of Maxima Acuña, one of the women that is defending her territory, because it's exactly there, near the lakes. When the whole struggle started against the Minera Yanacocha, they started to mobilize and going to the mountains, and there was severe repression from the state. 5 people were killed. 16 people have been accused of illegal charges because of the protest. And many more were in prison when there was almost 33 days of a strike, of national strike, regional strike in Cajamarca. So that's still ongoing, but that's a result of people defending their land and their territory. So what is what they are proposing? And in saying this, this was something that was building up, or better, constructed while I was there with the women that I visited, because I wanted to see from their perspectives how they see the extractivism and how they were affected because of that. Because you always hear about what is going to happen with the ecosystems, what is going to happen with Pachamama, but what happened with women? And so that was my first interaction with these women. It's called the Selendinas fighting for Pachamama. And you see at the top is Maxima, is the woman, is one of the persons that has been attacked constantly by Minera Yanacocha, and the woman has been there holding their land. It's a hat, what she has. And the attacks have been horrendous. I was one of those that was there, and also seeing what happened when the animals and the hat basically were destroyed by the guards. So what they were talking about when we were discussing about the issue, they were talking about, without naming it, they were talking about those elements that academics and some politicians in Latin America and a lot of people are talking about, which is the buen vivir, the Andean cosmovision of buen vivir. And why is that important, or why is that related to food sovereignty and to women? And this is, although it's in my
connected to feminism, called ecofeminism, I wanted to put it in the perspective of everybody in this planet, and every being has two components. We are feminine and we are masculine, and we share that. And in that manner, we are always connected. We are also connected with every single being in this planet. So we are related to each other, and if we harm nature, we harm ourselves. And besides that, there's not
the, we are surrounded of something that we, the invisible, that the Western world doesn't want to accept. We are surrounded of something else beyond this materiality. And it's not about, you know, like new era kind of talking, but it's a philosophy that people are talking about. It's an understanding of the world. And that's what Maxima, when she was talking, and the women, this is the women, part of the Selendinas, when they were explaining to me, but is the lake is alive. And when we go there to ask to the spirits, we are also mediating our relationship with nature so we can have what we need. But also we have to give something. It's not, the conception that this is anthropocentric, that the men, the man, and by the way, a white man, for that matter, is on top of the whole hierarchy of values of the Western philosophies. And then what they're saying is not. What we're saying is nature, we belong to nature. It's not like we own nature. We are part of that. And we are destroying nature, we are destroying ourselves. That was one of the elements, going back about the elements of the cosmovision of when we live or when living. The issue about interrelatedness, human beings and nature, and all those things that we don't see. But also, it's about complementarity. It's about complementarity between human beings and communities, and for that matter, with the local and the global. But then in which terms? In the terms of what? In terms of growth and limited growth? And that's what they say, and this is for many indigenous philosophies or indigenous cosmovision, is the concept of cyclicality. See this word, cyclicality. It's not linear. We are not going endless trying to get progress or destroy the planet because it's going to be there for us forever. It's not. We need to put an end to that. And it's something that's cyclical. So we need to respect those cycles in Mother Earth. And we see that. And that's what people practice. That's how people practice agriculture. And how people practice their own way of eating, their own way of living. The reciprocity, the solidarity they were talking. So when I was trying to understand what they were saying, all of these elements were coming together. And when they were saying, oh, this is what we're talking about. But the interesting thing is they don't name it. They didn't name it, these women. Later on, when I started, and what do you think about food sovereignty? That was the other element. They were saying, yes, what is to talk about? Why are you asking this question? Because it was so evident for them. But it's, of course, for someone that is coming outside and they, with all these questions, perhaps for the academia, you think that it's, that they are not aware. And the interesting thing is when they started to discuss about the whole process that they have with the militarization, they were saying, well, this is what we do. We are demanding that we have the right to decide what we eat, how we produce what we produce. It has to be in our own terms. We don't want to be eating what is imported, the bread, that horrible bread. Our potatoes are very important. We want to continue with that. But we also want to have a proper way of trading. We want to have our own markets. We want to have, be able to sell in the right prices. We also want to have to stop the using food as a weapon. We don't want to have these problems in our town because we are demanding to have our water and our land. And also, we want, as women, we want to be recognized. And one of the first things that they said when we were talking about the whole struggle, said, we know that people don't know about us. People always talk about men and then how they fought in the mountains, but we were there. We were the ones who were cooking in on the streets for the big mobilizations. We were looking after families. We were waking up very early to be able to meet the demonstrations. And they were really proud also saying, we even were there in the mountains where the whole Romans attack on the police, for the army happened. And that was, they say, women have a place. And thus, they were talking about women as a gender. And we consider that in the sense, they weren't talking in that moment about that conception of the whole nature as a totality of feminine, the feminine and the masculine side. But it was as a women, we want to be recognized for something that we are doing here. And I think the previous presentation gives some context to what I'm talking about. They were also talking about the impact, not just in terms of the food, but also in terms of their own lives. Young girls were seduced by armed groups, or the people, the military people were there. They couldn't say anything because of the whole stigma that come after that. They have to carry with a lot of burden in terms of carrying with the struggle, but also carrying with the families. At the beginning, their husbands and their relative wanted them to be in the struggle, but they continue, and actually they were the first ones to start to talk about the problem that they had with the animals when the animals were contaminated because of the contamination of the rivers. And they were the first one fighting to go outside and using even blankets to be able to have as a banners because they didn't have money to do anything. And they were so proud, but behind that pride, what they were showing was the solidarity. They were saying, well, this is what we bring to the struggle. This is what we bring, unity, but we also bring solidarity and understanding that we can bring something to the table. So, I thought that was really, really important for them to express in those meetings that we had. And then it came the issue about Maxi, because Maxima is, at the moment, is really well known internationally because of the whole problem that she has had. But what they were trying to say is that behind Maxima, there are many other Maximas. Maxima Cunha, behind that woman, a strong woman, tiny woman, but very strong, there were many women also behind that, so keeping the struggle. And that's, again, the issue about solidarity. And the solidarity that you understand as a mother, the solidarity you understand as a woman in this society, wanted or not. So that was, I think that was one of the big issues. But then when we started to talk about food sovereignty and what was the, how they perceive, how they, what was the result of the whole struggle? How they transform themselves, if they transform themselves or not. And that was really interesting because they started to acknowledge somehow that what they are doing were taking back their food system. That was the realization. And they would say, well, yes, like that, this, maybe you don't see that banner, but it says, sin oro se vive, sin agua se muere. You got it in the title. And they were saying, that's part of the whole business, but also, what we're doing here is connecting the rural with the urban. Because the struggle was between people in the rural areas and in the urban. And they were saying, we want people in the urban areas to understand that what they're eating is coming from the countryside. That is, and it should be like that. It's not coming from the supermarket or for the biggest supermarket. It's coming from the real people, the women, many of the women that are producing potatoes. This is, you know, Peru, there are, I think it's 200, I'm not forming that one, but it's 200 varieties of potatoes. And that's what we are going to lose. That's the biodiversity that we're going to lose if that extension of mineralogy approach is going to happen. And that's what they were talking about. Actually, this is when we were talking about the food sovereignty and the buen vivir, and they were saying, oh, it all makes sense. The only thing that didn't make sense is that somehow we are talking still from the point of view of the Western mentality, of the capitalist society, in terms of struggle, in terms of commodity, in terms of we have to fight it. But that's part of what the capitalist system is giving us. And it's part of the cracks that we need to take, but also it's part of the cracks that also can crack the movement of people. And the discussions were around that, how it's going to be, how can we unite communities around the issue of Mother Earth, of Pachamama? How we can unite communities around our food without the mentality of the capitalist system? And I think that, to me, that was one of the biggest transformations for myself as an external person. But also for them, I think that was the issue that they saw. Okay, this is, we are giving something in return of what we've been given by nature. And also another thing that I was quite powerful in the conversation with these women was that they were talking about how important for women was to talk about the issue, the whole repression, what happened in the fight, which is still ongoing. And it's something that is taken for granted, the whole need of healing that women, because women and men need in this process of repression when people are defending their territory. And with territory, I'm talking about all the things that I was saying about Pachamama, I'm not just talking about land or specific delimitation of geographic or state conceptions of that nature, but it's the whole Pachamama. And I think that's one of the elements as well that they were talking about. I don't know, I think it would be good to lead that, the conversation with you, in those terms. Not in terms of the Western mentality that we are still, we need to keep growing. We need to produce more food, which is a lie. And we know that somewhere is a lie, but still they're telling us we need to produce more food. We need to keep extracting every resource that Mother Earth has. And then maybe think in new terms how we can change that, revert that order, and also that will affect how we understand and how we fight for climate justice, which is what we were talking before, which is related to that. So I'm going to leave it with that, and then maybe I just
okay, some references that I think would be interesting for you, or to read the report that I was talking about before, which was is not published in any way, but it's an important report in terms of understanding what is going on in Peru, and also the Bolivian philosophy in Latin America. And I will leave it there. Happy to discuss.
So much for those talks. I thought that was very powerful to have the kind of international level and get a sense of what's going on internationally of these gender and climate issues as they relate to the right to food, and then a very specific example at the local level. It really nice, a very nice complementarity there. Thank you very much indeed. So I'd like to open it up to questions now. Who would like to start? And if you could say your name and where you're from, please. Thank you.
Thank you for interesting lecture. I'm Naho. I'm studying food policy in City University, and I want to ask you a question about from the perspective of right to food. I think increased production is very important, but as you said before, industrialization led a lot of negative impact on ecology and environment, but sustainable agriculture, such as organic agriculture, cannot increase production. So what kind of policy do you recommend to meet increasing demand and also protect environment?
Well, thank you very much for the question, because I didn't have a time at the end. I had these three proposals. One of the proposals, legal point of view, supporting the human rights. The other one is social movement, with the social, without a social movement, we are not going to reach anywhere. And also there's a technical kind of proposal, how do we get out or gradually move into more sustainable food systems, which is basically they are in the discussion, which agroecology is one of them. Basically, agroecology is not really well known around the world. Some countries are doing extremely well. There are very important reports on that. But there's also misunderstanding about the agroecology. Agroecology basically not only using traditional methods, but also using certain kind of methods that could be new, scientifically proven, but still connected with the local communities, and the teaching will be from farmer to farmer, more equal manner, rather than coming and teaching from outside. That's one important issue, how community-based agriculture helpful to locals more than the using the industrial food system. That's a huge area, and I don't think we have to talk more on that, but that's definitely there's an alternative. But I'm not sure completely we can get rid of the industrial agriculture. That's the one issue, that how do we make these two systems at least now work together and gradually move into more environmentally oriented system to agroecology. Certainly profit-wise, industrial agriculture is much more lucrative, but the agroecology is less damaging to the environment and more helpful to the local community, but I just talked with Corina from the nutrition's perspective. I'm not sure actually how it's going to be successful. So we need to go more further and deeper to do the research on that agroecology. Thank you.
Did you want to respond, or?
Maybe I can say something.
Of course, yeah.
I think the question is really, really important. And I think the last report from the previous Right to Food rapporteur names five elements in there. And I think one of them is that there is the need to definitely support new research in terms of agroecology, but also in terms of understanding the impact of the corporations on that research, but also in the food system. And they need to regulate the corporations and the power that they have. I think that's one of the elements. And the issue about governance, that was another element there, but I think like Hila was saying, it's important, the agroecology. We need to understand more about what we're talking about, agroecology. And there are new research on that, and how to bring cases, because that's one of the issues, that people want to bring cases to show that agroecology work in a larger scale, because that's the thing about the whole increase of food production. But it's also asking, do we have to increase the food production in the way that the industry likewise is doing it? Yes.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Anthony Lahal. I'm an alumnus from City University, graduate in international politics, but I spent a semester working under Martin Carraher, Professor Martin Carraher from the Institute. And I did a lot of research for it, and one thing that I came away from this long essay I had to write on the global financial crisis impact on food poverty was that the riots happened in 2007 and 8 in about 60 different countries. In 2009, the UN panel, they convened to say that you warned all the countries not to use the global financial crisis as an excuse to dismantle the welfare safety nets, which has happened in this country to about such an extent that charities have taken over because of the dismantling of the welfare net. What I'm trying to say is that it's this ideology that has caused this crisis. For example, Clinton deregulating the financial structure so they could trade in commodities that didn't even exist in futures and stuff. So how would you say that the UN can enforce this? Because there's a big hullabaloo that I think Olivia, I forget his second name, he was going to come and, that's right. He's going to come and the UK government doesn't have their human rights examined when it comes to human rights. But we've never heard anything, so I was hoping you could shed some light on that.
It's a very difficult. UN is a big organization, and they have variety of arms. One arm is doing good things, the other arm is destroying. So that's a kind of big, giant element, United Nations. So it's very difficult to make this connection. Definitely, Olivia's reports are very powerful and important to really, but as you said, how is it really possible changing the structure of the world? The structure of the global free market economy is extremely difficult because WTO, World Trade Organization, IMF, and other financial organizations have a different view about the way in which how we produce, how we live in the future. So that's a very, very difficult to access from the human rights perspective to break this kind of free market system, which is 2007, 2008 brought us a kind of turning point and thinking about how we're gonna deal with the future. Then we saw that also financial corporations
are understood that the food is a very important lucrative area. I mean, there are good things and the bad things happen after 2007 because we are paying attention right now, but at the same time, financial corporate interest is getting bigger and bigger. So how are we gonna deal with it? That's a very difficult, as long as we are in the capitalist system, if we don't make the monitoring mechanism powerful government institution, instead of deregulation, regulatory system would work. But if you look at the general trend that we are going, it's a deregulation. It's not the regulatory framework. It's a very, very difficult to understand what will happen in the future.
My name is Ellie Konsaravdis. I work for Nourish Scotland, which is an NGO campaigning on the right to food. I was just wondering if you could speak to women in positions of power within the right to food movement. And I'd like to note that Hilal, when you were appointed as a special rapporteur, I remember reading an article in which, I won't give credit, I won't even give airtime to this, but the commentator didn't refer to you by name, but he referred to you as Richard Falk's wife, which I thought was pretty outrageous, and I think it says something about women in positions of power within the right to food movement. Could you speak to that a bit, please?
It's a very delicate issue. There was a political problem on that. But it is, you are absolutely right. I mean, the right to food area, actually, in NGO level, we have a very, very good, successful NGO group. Basically, women are powerful. Here is Corinna, is one of the most important nutritious person in the right to food area. And I became the third special rapporteur as a female. Of course, the election process was, they never care about the gender. At least they say they don't look at the gender. Still, only 35% of the special rapporteurs are female. And if you look at the climate change, for instance, in the climate change environment, I know they try to make it more gender-friendly climate change policy. There's only 15% of the head of the governments are women, but to my experience, many of the governments are generally appoint women as a minister of environment because they think that minister of environment part of the cleaning. That's very true. And then they appoint the female ministers. This is definitely true. It is, I'm not joking about it. This was last 20 years like that. One or two ministers, one is the women and family ministers and the minister of environment. So it is a long way to go to make this kind of forget about the equality, even a little bit closer to be a decision-making mechanism, the way in which we are living in. But the food area, maybe it's becoming more and more important because, as I said, 2007 only FAO understood that women are important. Oh, we have to open a department that dealing with the women farmers. So we are on the way going there.
Thank you. There is another question here, but can I just ask a follow-up question to that? Thank you, which I may be more directed at you, but you presented, Graciela, you showed a women's movement struggling for the right to food is very much part of a peasants' movement. And nevertheless, I have. I remember very distinctly when I was living for 1 year in Brazil, interviewing the female only group of Via Campesina in Brazil, which is basically two women in a really, really small room in the poorest part of Brasilia. And they made a comment to me which reflected the male dominance of the Via Campesina and peasants movement. And I was talking to someone the other day who's working in Colombia on Via Campesina, on social movements, and he's interviewing them, and he said, and I said, how many were women? And he said like 2 out of 50 or something. So how does that play out? The women that you portrayed, do they separate themselves from men? Do they see themselves as different? Do they see that men are something that need to be fought, or are they very much part of the whole milieu? How does that work?
Yeah, it's really well known. The society is male dominated. It's a patriarchal society that we live in, and that's across all sectors. It's within social movements, within political spheres, and that's why I was talking before. Is we need to think this system in different ways. And I was saying in what I was talking before, the women were saying they couldn't go out because the men didn't believe what they were saying, that the animals were dying because of the contamination of the water. They were saying, yes, we want to be recognized in the struggle. And that is speaking by itself. It's saying, well, women, we have to struggle, we have to fight for our own place, no matter where, within the domestic sphere, within the social movements, with the academia, everywhere, because we live in a patriarchal system. And I think that's when the issue about women in positions of power, which power we're talking about. Because also sometimes when a woman gets appointed in certain levels, it's like you were saying, it's just the token. Let's put a woman and then if it's black, it's better. Yeah, because it fits all the boxes. And then we need also to understand that and being able to acknowledge it. And in the social movement, in the rural communities, in the peasant communities, we know it's a very patriarchal system. And in the indigenous communities is another matter. But still, you see some levels of that. But I think that's, I want to leave it like there. That's just with the concept of patriarchal, the patriarchal society that we live in, and we continue to perpetrate across sectors, across all levels of society. So, and I know within the La Via Campesina, they've been working on that. I know that I've been in discussions in small circles and those kind of levels of governance, and they've been discussing about the issue. It's not a simple one, and they acknowledge that. They acknowledge it's a big issue, and I remember the international meeting in Jakarta, that was one a big, big issue in terms of the position of women and the femicides and all the attacks against women. But again, I think if we need to is change the mentality in terms of patriarchal system. That's my answer to that.
Can I add one thing? Because this is important, I forgot to tell. If you look at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and Covenant of Economic and Social Rights, this is 1966. Man is responsible, or the old language is male. Even the human rights conventions in 1960s, we have the language of man. So.
Three things I think I'd like to connect or ask you about. One on the paradigm. One of the other paradigms is about control, I think, that we as human beings have control over the environment. And if you look at the direction of travel at the moment, at the base of the food system, we've got the mergers with China Chem and Syngenta, Bayer, Monsanto, likely to move on to the big, basically having a one or two, three firms running the base of the system, the equipment, the seeds, the lot, using a lot of new technology, which will be toys for boys. Because again, it's the men who tend to use the tractors and you'll see the large scale developments, even the cooperatives turning into that way. So there's an issue around how do you rein in corporate power under the SDGs, which apply to rich and poor countries, there is also a role to actually start to hold corporations to account. And we need to look at the legal mechanisms to do that. So I'd be interested if you any insights onto that. The second thing I wanted to raise was in connection with the UK, because last year I chaired the Fabian Commission on Food and Poverty, where there is in Scotland, and Ellie can probably, is she gone? That's a real shame, because I think she's just come from Geneva, where she was challenging the UK's record on the right to food. Nourish Scotland presented a brief there. And in Scotland, there is a real discussion going on about introducing the right to food in the law so it would be justiciable, so you could actually take legal action. So I think that's an issue about the law and how we can actually use the law. The third thing I want to raise at some is my wife, when she did her master's degree on gender and science and history of science, kept pointing out gender is not about women or men. It's about the gendered nature of the roles that we absorb socially, as well as the power relations. So if we restrict the discussion to women, we also have to look at the gendered roles that men have been taken or want to take or take on. And I think there's an issue about how we look at gender as something that traps or can be used to trap people in particular roles. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, but that last comment you made me think back to that, because gender is there's a biological facts of male and female, but gender is a lot about social relationships and power structures and so forth.
Of course, the gender is socially constructed. It's the sex is different. Sex is more biological, but the gender we socially constructed, and we give the roles women and men. And when the children was born, exactly, it's happening in everywhere. Even now, they are trying to change. They don't give the toys to children that gender sort of. Insensitive, let's put it this way. So that's a long way, and we can discuss the whole night here on this issue. Definitely social construction. Using law, definitely, we need a more activist judges and lawyers in order to use the legal materials. We have enough legal materials, we have enough documents, even in the Western part of the society, in UK or US or other parts. We can use the human rights system without really ratifying the economic and social rights, because right to life is the one of the major right that comes all the health and the food and the water and environment underneath. So there's no question we need an activist judge. Some activist judge, for instance, did in India. So then other in the Brazil, and I think there are other countries. Well, Guatemala was a good example recently. They had a very important Supreme Court decision about the stunting children. So why not UK NGOs would work with the lawyers and some kind of judge that they are willing to go against this kind of systemic problem? That would be definitely possible. Come to the corporate responsibility. This is more difficult and more problematic part, because human rights system basically make responsible governments, that the citizens can go against the governments in relation to human rights violation, but we can't directly go to human rights violation against corporations. If there's a criminal activity, definitely we go, but if there's no criminal activity, only the human rights violation, the states should make necessary regulatory system that we can directly make them responsible. That's the what we call state's responsibility. And as you know, in recent years, corporations are coming basically developed countries, and they are acting really badly in the developing countries. If you look at the all mining corporations are not coming from, about 60% of them are coming Canada, for instance. And the others are a variety of the developed countries. So we need an extraterritorial application of these principles, which means we have the host country, we have the home country. Basically, according to now international law principles, if there is some violation, for instance, let's say Peru, Peruvian law, Peruvian government is responsible to act against corporations, but this is not enough because Parisian government is not strong enough to go against such a multinationals. Then we have to be we have to have a certain kind of legal weapon to go against companies like Canada, countries like Canada, United States, or UK or Switzerland to make them corporations responsible. As of today, only we have voluntary guidance, and voluntary responsibility is not the regulatory. Some corporations are voluntarily announced that they are responsible in certain kind of act, but this is also very limited to what they call not completely strict liability, but due diligence, which means if they have some kind of fault, then you can they can be responsible. But if there is no fault, there is no responsibility as of international law today.
I think it's a tricky issue about the use of institutional regulations for to put it like that. What happens if they manage to go ahead with TTIP? Basically, we are in the hands of corporations because they're already doing it. We know that there are so many cases of corporations against the states because they are losing their own investment in those countries. And if that goes ahead, there's already the International Settlement Court dispute in between companies and corporations, and there are more and more cases in those courts. So I think the use of regulations at that level of law is something that is an instrument, but I do think that the understanding of social movements and then the civil society empowerment and education on those issues is and the mobilization of people is what makes a difference sometimes. Because the more you see the entrenchment of the it's not anymore about the states, it's about the capital. It's about capital defending their own ways. And it's not about the country of Peru, for example, in the case of Yanacocha. Peru is part; it has 5% of the ownership of that mine. So it's a completely collusion there, and it's not that the power that they have is the whole system that is in terms of governability, and the cases in terms of law that there's no favoring of the planet or people. So I think that the TTIP is a clear example that is not enough, even if there are national regulations. If the trade agreement goes ahead, the whole Europe will be, maybe all countries will be sued by companies, as is happening at the moment.
Thank you both for all your comments. I'm Helen Atkins, I'm from the Center for Alternative Technology. We do a series of reports. Forthcoming is Zero Carbon Britain, and there's a key chapter on land use and food and diet. So that's published in September, just to draw your attention to that. I'm particularly interested in your thoughts on how to reconcile the two extremes, as food is something which is fuel, is crucial for survival, and as a baseline indicator that everyone should have enough to eat. And at the other extreme, particularly being somewhere like London, a global center for fine dining, where for some people a hallmark of evolution is to produce the most extravagant, luxurious food. An example is at Paris at COP21, where a friend reported that one of the canapés was a foam, which was created out of smog from 8 different countries around the world. So that has obviously a however you look at it, whether it's very symbolic or whether it's ludicrous or offensive, I don't know, but it really seems to me to encapsulate these two incredible polarization that we're dealing with here. And how do we go about doing that within the time frame of great urgency that we have? Okay, so the drinks reception, there were canapés, and one of the canapés had a foam. And the foam was made out of smog particles collected from 8 different cities around the world.
There were were a lot of things like that in Paris. I mean, and the French were so proud of how sustainable food served in the place which I was there. People were eating hamburger or anything, pizza. I don't know what sustainability was they are talking about. I mean, it was completely a travesty. So how do we, as far as I understand your question, the luxurious kind of organic food business you talk about, or
I suppose it's more a question of perception. We have here, you know, lots of very engaged and mobilized people, but it's a niche group in society, and the debate and the dialogue doesn't tend to trickle through to the mainstream. And in the mainstream, things like aspirational meat eating, for example, particularly in developing countries where a hallmark of development is to have meat and as much meat as possible, as regularly as possible. So there's various different points I'm making here, I suppose, but it's just how do we deal with this in terms of where we're headed as a global society?
Yeah, I think climate change or a climate justice movement, it really is happening right now. But I'm not sure about the food movement, food sovereignty movement, as visible as it is. Because when I go to countries for mission trips, I meet with the NGOs, and there's a very little understanding about the right to food and food security, why it's so important, why we are talking about it. I'm searching all kind of places to find the right NGO that sit and dealing with what kind of food issues they have. Unfortunately, it is not in the agenda right now. The only you go to countries like United States or Europe, there's a more city-oriented NGOs that they talk about the local food movement, organic food, or a kind of food that only you can eat, seasonal. But this is a very elite, very boutique type of, I would say boutique, that I don't think this is going to make the whole world food conscious. There is no question about it. But the climate justice is different, because climate justice started very early, and they made a big kind of head-on right now. The many countries, even the developing countries, they deal with the climate change, they deal with the policies, NGOs are working on that, certainly not food. That's my impression.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for the talks and for this discussion. Now, it's really interesting. I'm Carla Kay. I'm doing a PhD at the Center for Agroecology, Water and Resilience also. I just wanted a very brief comment, Hilal. You said industrial agriculture is definitely the most lucrative, having in mind our flawed system. That little ending for me is just so important with all the subsidies and everything. Yeah, definitely it is lucrative. But if we change that, it'd be probably quite different. I had a question for Graciela. I was really interested in your talk. I didn't know much about this, so for me it was quite new. It's good. So yeah, you talked about women. You talked about the links between urban and rural, and how, for example, what would happen would farmers go then live in the cities. I was interested also in a wider aspect. So regionally, so are women gathering and discussing within the city? Regionally in America, or even with Europe, is mining perceived a bit like climate change? So I study West Africa, so you know, it's like, oh, it's created by other people, but we're suffering the impact, so they need metals. I don't know which ones are being extracted there, but they need them for their mobile phones, but we're suffering here. How is it perceived, and how are they organizing and creating links with Europe and richer countries? Also shows that there are similarities and not, you know, an enemy and us. So I'd be interested in hearing more about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Carla. I'm going to start with that, and maybe you want to.
No.
That, okay. I was in the first international conference on mining, the People's Mining Conference in the Philippines, in Manila. And there were key issues, was the group of women representing networks across the whole world, from Latin America, from Asia, and from Africa. And it was so interesting when we were discussing issues and how people are taking forward the issue about women and extractivism. And it's very nascent, but it's very powerful. When you say, for example, the role that they have in terms of uniting communities for rural and urban areas is very much true, and it's happening in the case, for example, that I was living with the women in Peru. The whole group, a collective of women, is not, that was an interesting question as well. People were thinking that they were just middle class people trying to teach the peasants how to do things. You saw the pictures. They are peasant women. They are women who are producing food, they are cooking, they are selling in the market, but also they are teachers, they are nurses. One of the not even nurses is a health promoter, which is a different rank in that system. And they were part of the movement. So it's the issue about the unity they are talking about. It's not a movement of women for certain sector. It's a cross-sectoral, and it's across ages. There were young girls, they were doing the placards and painting. They did beautiful murals in the city of Selendín. And so it's cross-sectoral. But how they unite, I think that was one of the interesting issues, was through the need of water and the need of food. And when one of the outcomes that they want to pursue now is setting up like fairs, local fairs, to be able to bring the food and then show what the farmers are producing. And it's again joining the not even middle class. We're talking about poor people in Selendín working with the indigenous people. Now the Red, for example, the Red Latin Americana, the women on mining is a big network in the whole Latin America. They are joining struggles with people in different countries. I think they even have a relationship with the fracking movement here in the UK. So I think this is one of the issues that, although it's not visible, is happening. And I think it's taking a little bit of time to get that. The women, for example, in Africa, there is one network working on women in mining. Women is called Women in Mining. Is the network in Africa and with the secretariat in Johannesburg in South Africa. I think they also have a big role to play, but I guess it's incipient. And perhaps incipient for the whole society, because this is, again, is the work that we do behind the scenes and it's not seen. So that's part, but definitely there's a big movement in terms of women on the extractivism. And I think the connections now between food sovereignty and the issues of food systems, food regimes, with the extractivism is getting closer. And I think that's very powerful as well. That movements like Via Campesina, I'm sure they are talking about these issues. You know, and they are manifesting when things happen, like the issue with Berta. So I think that's one element. I think that was before, and the two questions before, is the point. I want to take the opportunity to say, I think we need to, the paradigm that Jove was talking before, the paradigm in terms of genders, in terms of class. I think it's important to think about the whole issue about intersectionality. That I know a friend knows a lot about that behind there, but also the issue about is not men and women, is what the cosmovision is talking about. It's the wholeness of this issue. It's the wholeness of nature, and we understanding part of that. And yeah, it's a difficult political issue, sensitive issue, and I'm not going to say, yes, women, we have a fight to give, but it's from the different perspective of the capitalist system, because otherwise we are doomed. If we do it from that angle, we lose it. We don't even start.
I was going to say we've got time for one more when we've got two hands up. So can I just get, can you just be quite brief?
I'm not even sure I need this. Right, my name is Dee. I'm not an academic. I'm not anything like that. I am someone on the ground. I work with ordinary people who articulate these food issues in a different way. And what I wanted to ask, how is the UN and researchers going to connect to ordinary people on the ground?
I should have said before, the special rapporteurship position is a quite interesting system. We are not United Nations civil servants. We don't have a salary, and nobody can fire us because they didn't hire us. So we are completely independent. We can go any country, say anything, and the secretary, even the, against the Secretary General, we have certain kind of protection from the UN bureaucracy, which is highly problematic. So the one thing. The second thing, we are, as you know, United Nations is the institution of the sovereign states. States, but not people. So what we can do as a special rapporteur, and we are doing it, we are bridging between this state system and the international system with ordinary people. What we do go to countries and we meet with the ordinary people. We go to their homes and the farms and the schools and asking them what are the problems. We put our reports and then we can bring the United Nations. That is the only thing the UN would connect with the people. Maybe there are other ways the way they are doing it, but the one thing that special rapporteurs are able to do that, to give the voice to ordinary people. That's the one thing I am strongly able to do that. The rest is problematic.
Sort of one of my thoughts is about gender, and one of them is not. The gender one is that you're appealing to a gendered archetype when you talk about Mother Nature, and I wondered whether you think that's helpful or unhelpful to men or women. And my second thought is that a lot of my work has been involved with food corporations, and I've come to the conclusion, an observation is that they are also social constructs and legal constructs, and that means that they can be legally changed, and also the people in them can change. So there can be, like as in social movements, huge corporations, I like to think, the whole mentality of them might change and they might conduct themselves differently. It's a possibility.
It's an interesting observation at the end of the conversation. And I would like to finish saying that from my point of view, on the second issue about corporations, I don't want to go into the area of thinking that all of us are human beings and for that matter we can change. Because yes, we can change as a human beings, definitely. The issue about corporations is beyond that. The issue about corporations and capital is beyond that. And we know that is beyond the issue about individuals and human beings. Sorry?
Beyond.
So I think that's really, really important. And I wouldn't like to finish thinking that it's all about changing individuals and then that will be better. Because the history, and it's a long, long history about the corporations and the control that you were talking about of corporations in terms of, just leave it just for the food system, that is quite problematic to leave it like that. I will say that yes, it's possibility to change, but there is a lot of organizing, mobilizing people and educating people what's going on, because people don't know. Normal people don't know what's going on. They don't even know what a corporation is. They don't even know that actually we are eating chicken that are treated in an inhuman way. People don't know those kind of things. They don't want, I've been in talks with people when they say, I didn't know that. And that's part of what a corporation is doing in the food system. So I think it's important to be conscious of that. And yes, human beings, we can change. And I love that idea that we can change. In terms of the gender issues and the mother nature, I'm transmitting something that was transmitted to me, and I believe that definitely we are not independent from nature. We are not independent from or able to say we are going to control or we are going to transform nature in the way that we want and nothing is going to happen. I think nature is alive. And it's a being that is alive that we need to treat with respect. And in the same way that we don't want to be exploited, that being doesn't want to be exploited. And we have the picture about the mind is a clear picture. Anyway. I think that when we are talking about those terms in terms of feminine or masculine, that's what I was talking before. You have, and I have, as a woman, I have my other element, my other part. And that's what they're talking about. We are a whole of something the same like the mother. So I'm not talking about feminization of nature. That was from the very beginning of the talk. I was saying we are the two things. That's what makes us a whole. And that's what the capital system is making us divided. And then believing that it's you and me. And the other one is another part, the other. Even the other, the otherness, is that conceptualization of the Western sense that you are the other. Actually, you are mine other as well. It's mine. And I'm related to you. So that's what they are talking about. I think this is a whole discussion, and I invite you to read more about that, because it's an issue that is not easy to understand, especially when we were being educated in the system that we've been educated. But I'm not talking about the feminization. Perhaps there are some school of thought that do that, but maybe that's for another discussion.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Well, thanks very much for all those questions. I have to say, throughout this discussion, there seems to be a lot of complexity. There's so many different issues that we're trying to connect in gender and climate change and food and all of the other issues that we've talked about. But it seems that nevertheless we all have a role to play, men and women. And there's only small things perhaps we can do, but we can at least try to keep on fighting and within that complexity and see where that gets us. So thank you very much for those inspirational talks and for those questions. And as I said, there's a reception now, so please join the speakers. Thank you very much.